in spite of the very strong conviction as to the importance of toposes that Grothendieck had, actually the mathematical community didn't share exactly the same kind of enthusiasm, and Grothendieck had several occasions to complain about that, especially about the reception of toposes from his own community of reference, which was that of algebraic geometers, so his former pupils, etc. But there are also some words that Grothendieck reserves for logicians, etc. So there are a number of interesting passages in Récoltes sémailles which is this autobiographical text by Grothendieck, which is a very, very interesting source of reflections on his mathematical discoveries and experiences also with his colleagues. So I will present a number of excerpts, mostly from this text. And then, as I anticipated, I will present very, very briefly this use that one can make of toposes as bridges for realizing transfers of knowledge between different contexts. And I will briefly present a couple of examples to give you an idea of how things work. And then I will say a few words about future perspectives arising from this approach. Okay, so let's start with the background. In fact, the role of toposes as unifying spaces is intimately tied to the possibility of regarding these objects from multiple points of view. So there are three main classical viewpoints on this concept, which have emerged in the years immediately after the appearance of the concept. So the first incarnation of the notion of toposes in the context of algebraic geometry, so the concept was introduced by Grothendieck himself, and the idea was to get a generalized notion of space. And so we have this first point of view, of which I will say more in a minute. Then this original geometric perspective was complemented a few years later by an approach which was mostly contributed by categorical logicians, mostly Lovier and Tierney, the point of view of a topos as a mathematical universe with its own internal logic, which to a certain extent is captured by a specific object inside the topos called its subobject classifier, and a universe in which one can develop mathematics in a quite a similar way as one does in the classical set theoretic setting, with just one very important exception, which is the necessity to work to reason constructively, that is by avoiding principles such as the low excluded middle, the axiom of choice, or strong set theoretic assumptions, etc. So this is a second perspective, which already emerged in the 60s, 70s. Then there is a further perspective, which in fact already, as we shall see, dates back to Grothendieck's work, and more precisely to the thesis of a Grothendieck's student, Monica Kim, the point of view of toposes as classifying spaces for certain kinds of first order theories. Of course, considered up to an equivalence relation which identifies them when they have the same classifier. So this is called Morita equivalence. So this is a third viewpoint, which is inspired, of course, by the Yonida paradigm, which is the idea of understanding an object within a category in terms of its generalized elements, in terms of the morphisms to that object from arbitrary objects of the same category. And so, of course, it provides a third perspective on this, this notion. And all of this was already well understood in the 70s. But then, as we shall see in the following years, these aspects have not really been integrated so much with each other. Both the geometers and the categorical logicians have privileged a very specific study of toposes in one direction or in another, and so they have not really pushed so much forward this unification aim, which Grothendieck had, in the sense that the focus was not put on an interdisciplinary use of toposes for transferring knowledge between different contexts. So as I already said, this has been my main preoccupation since the times of my PhD studies, and throughout the years I have developed a number of techniques which actually allow one to start giving substance to this. Okay, but before saying more about this theory of bridges, we have to recall each of these more classical perspectives. Okay, so how were toposes born? Well, the notion of topos was introduced in the early 60s by Grothendieck with a very specific motivation in mind. So the aim was to design a new cohomology theory adequate for proving the Bayes conjectures. So it was already clear to Bay that it was not possible to limit oneself to topological spaces in order to obtain such a cohomology theory. So it was necessary to go beyond the realm of topology and to design an object which allowed the definition of cohomological invariants in a formally analogous way, as it is possible to do for topological spaces, but which was not strictly of topological origin. And so this is how Grothendieck came out with this notion of topos. So there are two basic steps which were decisive in arriving at this notion. So the first step was to realize that one could understand many important properties of the topological spaces directly in terms of invariant properties of the associated categories of sheaves of sets on this. So, for instance, it is possible to understand whether a space is compact or connected or many other topological properties you might think of directly in terms of the associated category of sheaves. Which is quite striking if you think about it, because a topological space is something in terms of internal structure quite poor. While the category of all sheaves of sets on this space is a very rich category. So it is an object which can also be studied algebraically, since it is a category. In terms of internal structure, it is extremely rich, as we shall see. In fact, we have all limits and colimits. Inside such a category, we can perform all the usual constructions we make for sets, etc. Of course, always with the exception that we should reason constructively, but still, I mean, we have a whole universe with a very rich internal structure at our disposal. And so, in fact, this passage from a topological space to the associated category of sheaves can be thought, and again, using Grothendieck's words, as a metamorphosis of the notion of space. So Grothendieck really talks about toposes as metamorphose de la notion d'espace. So it means that really we can think about topology in a completely different way using the language of category theory. But then Grothendieck took a further step, which was fundamental because it allowed one to go beyond the classical realm of topology, which was the step of defining sheaves on something more general than a topological space, namely a site. So Grothendieck realized that it is possible to define sheaves on any category endowed with a notion of covering families, in it. So which is what is called a growth endictopology. So giving a growth endictopology on a category amounts essentially to specify a number of covering families of objects of the category by arrows going to it, subject to some natural conditions. So given a site, which by definition is just a small category and a growth endictopology on it, one can define a notion of sheaf on this site. And by considering all sheaves on the site, one gets a category, which is denoted like this, sheaves on CJ, on the site CJ. And this actually generalizes the construction of sheaves on a topological space, because to any topological space one can attach a site, so the underlying category is category of open sets of the space, and the growth endictopology is given by the usual notion of covering that we have in topology of an open set by a family of open subsets. And so we get a site, and then by considering sheaves on this site, we get the same notion of sheaf we are used to on the space. So this is marvelous because, as you can see, it is a very significant generalization. It shows that one can build categories of sheaves, and a topos is defined by Grothendieck as any category equivalent to a category of sheaves on a site. So it means we can build toposes from essentially whatever mathematical context in which we have a category and a generalized notion of covering on it. And so, thanks to this generalization, it was in particular possible to define the et al. Topos and the et al. Cohomology theory, which has been a fundamental tool in algebraic geometry for many decades and even today. In connection with the notion of topos, it is important to remark that in some sense toposes are natural supporters for invariants. In fact, cohomology is one of the most fundamental invariants of toposes that one can define. In fact, Grothendieck developed the general formalism of cohomology in the general setting of toposes up to the so-called six operation formalism, and this led to a great clarification also of the formal properties of the usual cohomological theory of topological spaces. Still, it is important to remark that we can consider invariants of toposes which have a completely different nature from cohomological invariants. For instance, we can consider homotopy theoretic invariants on toposes, such as the fundamental group or even higher homotopy groups. And in fact, since a topos is a category, basically any categorical property, any genuine categorical property, even a property which requires the consideration of certain limits and colimits, since the latter exist in toposes, can be considered on a topos, and it will be automatically invariant, since the notion of the criterion of identity for toposes is simply given by categorical equivalence of the underlying categories. So it is very important to realize that on toposes we can consider all sorts of invariants, not just cohomological or homotopy theoretic invariants, but invariants of whatever kind. For instance, logicians identified an important invariant, as I mentioned, the subobject classifier in a topos. So it is an invariant of the topos. Or we can consider whatever categorical property we want on a topos. For instance, the property of a topos to be two-valued, to be Boolean, to be De Morgan, etc. So, I mean, we have really infinitely many invariants that we can consider on toposes, And it is always possible without difficulty to introduce new invariants just because, as I said, the criterion of identity is simply categorical equivalence. So, I mean, if I ask you to fabricate invariants under categorical equivalence, you realize that it is quite straightforward. Mm-hmm. So it means that toposes are places which naturally support a lot of different invariants. Why all of this is relevant in connection with unification? Well, because, in fact, as we shall see, this unification happens precisely by looking at invariants of toposes from different points of view provided by different presentations of this toposes. So, basically, what one does is, for any given invariant, one investigates how this invariant expresses itself in the context of different presentations. They can be sites or theories or whatever other object used to build a topos. And actually, by making such an investigation, one unveils an authentic mathematical morphogenesis because, in fact, even very simple invariants defined at the toposphoretic level can manifest themselves in completely different forms in the context of different presentations. And so, as you can imagine, this leads to many deep, unexpected connections between different mathematical contexts just arising from this morphogenesis of invariants. But I shall give some examples later about this. Now, let's come back to our review. I would like just before passing to the second viewpoint, just read some very nice considerations about the nature of toposes by Grothendieck, which illuminate the nature of this, this concept. So Grothendieck says, and this also anticipates these controversial aspects concerning the reception of toposes that we shall address later. Grothendieck says, like the very idea of sheaf, which in fact was already introduced by Leray, or that of scheme, like any great idea which upsets an inveterate vision of things, that of topos has something to disconcert by its naturality or evidence, by its simplicity. At the limit, one would say, by its innocence or simplistic character, or even its stupidity. Of course, it's very ironic about that, but by this particular quality, which makes us cry out so often, oh, it is only that, in a tone half disappointed, half envious, with in addition, perhaps, this implication of eccentric, of not serious, that one often reserves for all that confuses by an excess of unforeseen simplicity. To what comes to remind us, perhaps, of the long buried and denied days of our childhood. This is very, very fascinating. In fact, if you have read Grothendieck, you know that the theme of childhood is very important for him. In fact, Le thème de l'enfant is the key for creativity for Grothendieck. This innocence, this childish innocence, is crucial for creativity. So for him, childish is not a negative attribute, quite the opposite. But of course, he realizes that his colleagues tend to be quite disconcerted by this childish character of toposes. He remarks quite rightly, in fact, because I have made myself the experience of witnessing this lack of understanding. He actually remarks that it can be quite disconcerting for people to apprehend this this notion. In fact, after talking about this childish nature of the concept of topos, he remarks that, in fact, he doesn't see anyone else on the mathematical scene during the past three decades who could have had this naivety or this innocence to take in my place this other crucial step among all, introducing the childish idea of topos, or even that of size, which for him was the way to arrive at toposes, but which is of course most more concrete. But we shall come back to that later when we talk about the reception of the toposes. So for the moment, I would like just to briefly introduce this second viewpoint on toposes, which emerged through the work of Lovier and Tierney in the 60s. So they decided to study Grothendieck toposes from a logical point of view, and they discovered that, in fact, a Grothendieck topos actually can be seen as a mathematical universe with its own internal logic, and which therefore can be a place where one can do mathematics. In the sense that one can reproduce to a certain extent the usual constructions that one can consider in the familiar set theoretic setting. So of course this was a quite important point of view because it paved the way for a relative way of doing mathematics, because we no longer have just one mathematical universe in which we are forced to work, but we can change the universe according to our needs. So this gives a lot of flexibility to construct new mathematical worlds with particular properties. And also to consider models of mathematical theories, in particular first order ones, not just in the classical set theoretic setting, but inside every topos. And in fact, this has striking consequences, as we shall see in a moment when we talk about the classifying toposes, because there exist classification results for models of first order theories if one considers them in the extended topos theoretic context that aren't available in the restricted set theoretic setting. So here we come to this point of view of classifying toposes, which, as I anticipated, dates back to the PhD thesis Topos Annelé et Schéma Relatif of Monique Akin, who was one of the last students of Grothendieck. In which sense this point of view dates back to the thesis? Well, in the sense that in that work, four toposes relevant for algebraic geometry were investigated from the point of view of the structures that they classified. And in fact, it was shown that they could be characterized as the classifiers of certain specific kinds of rings. For instance, the Zariski topos was shown to classify local rings. The et al. Topos was shown to classify strictly Encilian local rings, etc. But this was limited to just four specific toposes relevant for algebraic geometry. Still, Grothendieck realized about the generality of such a point of view, and in fact, in SGA4, he explicitly talks about more general classifying toposes that one can build. So, more precisely, he talks about classifying toposes of structures which can be expressed in terms of finite projective limits and arbitrary inductive limits, and explicitly poses the problem of formalizing these structures. So this is the passage in which he refers to that. And it is quite funny that he qualifies the task of formalizing these structures as uninviting. So he says, rather than entering the uninviting task of giving a precise meaning to this statement and of justifying it formally, we advise the reader to make it explicit and to get convinced of its validity. Validity in the sense of the existence of classifying toposes for species of structures such as that of group, ring, module over a ring, commodule over a ring, biallgebra over a ring, torsor for a group. So it was quite clear from this passage that Grothendieck had identified, not formally, but had a precise idea about the structures which admitted classifying the toposes. But this uninviting task of making all of this precise was fortunately taken by several categorical logicians during the 70s, leading to the elaboration of geometric logic. And this was actually a quite important development in spite of Grothendieck's consideration, because in fact, thanks to this formalization, it was possible to prove a quite striking theorem, the existence of classifying toposes for all first-order geometric theories. I don't go into the details of what a geometric theory is, but I can tell you that the level of generality of geometric logic is more or less the same as full first-order logic. So it is a very, very wide class of theories which admit classifying toposes in the sense that to any such theory, it is possible to associate a topos which is characterized by the universal property which you see there. So the identification between the geometric morphisms from an arbitrary Grothendieck topos to the classifying topos on the one hand, and the models of the theory inside that topos on the other. So as you can see, this provides a functorial understanding of models of the theory in arbitrary topos, toposes, in particular in the classical topos of sets. So here is a picture of a classifying topos, where I have depicted with a yellow dark star a classifying topos, and inside it what I call U, the universal model of the theory, which is obtained, you see, in this equivalence here, you can take the identity on the left hand side, and on the right hand side you get a model corresponding to it. And since this equivalence should be natural in E by Ioannida, it means that one can obtain any possible model of the theory in an arbitrary topos. Here I have considered different models, M, N, and P, in different toposes represented by these different color shapes. So one can obtain each of them as images of this universal model under structure preserving functors, which are just inverse images of geometric morphisms. Mm-hmm. So as you can see, we have a sort of center of symmetry of our theory, which is this universal model lying in the classifying topos, and everything else which happens in the theory is just a deformation of something which lies at this level. Mm? So this classification result, which in particular applies to set-based models of a theory because they become points of the classifying topos, is an example of a result which is only possible if one works in the extended topospheretic context and not just in the restricted set theoretic context, because these universal models are not standard set-based models, but they are models internally to a topos. So it is the price to pay to have this classification is to consider models in arbitrary toposes and not just in sets. Okay, very good. So now that we know about the classifying toposes, we can wonder whether it is possible for two mathematical theories to have the same classifying topos. And in fact, this is possible, and it is even a very interesting phenomenon, which is strictly related to the unification that toposes can realize. Different theories can indeed have the same classifying topos. They are called Morita equivalent, if this is the case. And broadly speaking, it means that they describe in different languages the same structures. So it's like having different perspectives on the same mathematical content, which is incarnated by the common classifying. So in fact, every Grothendieck topos can be seen as the classifying topos of some theory. Of course, this theory is not uniquely determined. There are in general infinitely many theories classified by a given topos. But we can conclude that a topos can be seen as a canonical representative of equivalence classes of theories modulo Morita equivalence. And this concludes the presentation of these three classical perspectives on topos. Now I would like to pause a little on the reception on of toposes, because it is a very interesting subject to consider both mathematically and also sociologically, because in fact, in spite of the great enthusiasm that Grothendieck had about this notion of topos, the reception of toposes within the mathematical community has been quite negative. And in fact, there are various passages in which Grothendieck complains about that, mostly from Récolte and Semaille. So here, for instance, he says that it was his own name even that over the years had become an object of derision as a synonym for muddy, endless spooling. The French word is bobinage, such as those on those famous toposes or even motifs, etc., that people were looking at this notion of topos in a quite negative way, as something very heavy, not strictly necessary. Like, he uses this funny expression, air cut in four to the length of 1,000 pages, because of course, I mean, Grothendieck, when he took the pen, and he went on for hundreds and thousands of pages. But this was quite negatively perceived. He also talks about bloated and gigantic chatter on things which actually people didn't appreciate and even regarded as things that everyone has always known and without having expected them. So I mean, a very, very negative reception, which I have to say, I find this quite striking, because I suffered myself from exactly the same kind of accusation, not very much from the geometers, even more from category theories, but still it was the same kind of accusation, like these machines are too big, it is too general, it is we don't need all of that, etc. So indeed, it is a very widespread attitude in the community, and not just from on the part of geometers, to which to whom Grothendieck was primarily referring to, but even on the part of categorical logicians who came later. Here are another set of examples of complaints that Grothendieck makes about the lack of understanding of the metamathematical significance of the notion of topos. Here you can see this expression, crucial unifying notion, which I mentioned at the beginning. And also what is very interesting is the way he refers to this notion, the fruitful unifying idea and the powerful tool of discovery, you see, which is the notion of topos. So he was fully aware of the importance of this notion, but he sadly remarks that it is maintained by a certain circle, banished from the notions deemed to be serious, etc., etc., and that has been condemned since his departure to a marginal existence. And so, of course, he's very saddened by all of this. And of course, he spends a lot of time trying to understand the reasons for this lack of understanding without actually arriving at any definite conclusion, but certainly he suffered a lot from this. In particular, it makes a difference between the understanding of the concrete tools arising from the troposphere vision, in particular etal cohomology, and the rejection of the vision provided by the general language of toposis. So basically, to say things shortly, he says people have discredited the unifying vision, and on the other hand, they have appropriated the tool, especially concerning etal cohomology. He is referring in particular to the book SGA 4.5 by Pierre Deligne, in which, in fact, the authorship is by Deligne, and then the subtitle is with the collaboration of Alexander Grothendieck and other people. So he complains about this appropriation attempt, which was also partly successful, it must be said, by some of his former students. It is also quite interesting to consider the way logicians have apprehended toposes, which also doesn't actually go in the direction Grothendieck would have hoped. Because, in fact, what happened after the 70s, after geometric logic was introduced, is that essentially the community of category theorists and categorical logicians have more or less abandoned the study of Grothendieck toposes as classifiers of geometric theories in order to work on other subjects that looked to them more promising, such as the subject of elementary toposes by Lovir and Tierney. So what is an elementary topos? Well, it is a kind of category more general than the notion of Grothendieck topos, which actually differs from Grothendieck toposes, notably by the fact of being finitely axiomatizable in the language of categories, but which has the defect of not having all colimits and also not being representable by sites. I mean, if an elementary topos is representable by a site, it is a Grothendieck topos. So, I mean, the main difference between these two notions is the fact that in an arbitrary elementary topos, it is not really possible to do geometry, because you see, if you want to do geometry or topology, you need to take arbitrary colimits. You see, one of the fundamental topological operations is to take arbitrary unions of open sets, and this is a colimit. So if you don't have arbitrary colimits, you are very much in trouble to develop any geometry. And also there is a problem, which is the lack of sites, which actually prevents one from connecting toposes to the mathematical concreteness, to specific mathematical context, as Grothendieck was doing. I mean, in the first citation, Grothendieck refers to the possibility of incarnating the essence of a mathematical situation through a topos. And this is done by constructing a topos from that context using a certain presentation, which in most cases is a site. It can be something else, but still one should work with Grothendieck toposes in the sense of categories that can be presented by means of generators. And for elementary toposes, we don't have that. So essentially, if we want to resume these two different attitudes, that of geometers on the one hand and that of category theorists on the other, we should say that geometers actually practiced sites without toposes, in the sense that they only cared about specific cohomological theories attached to sites of geometric origin, attached to schemes, without actually valorizing as much as they could have the invariant nature of the notion of topos for computing even the invariants they were interested in, mostly cohomological invariants from other perspectives. And on the other hand, in a sense, categorical logicians practiced toposes without sites. I mean, this development of the theory of elementary toposes is goes into the direction of studying toposes without reference to their presentations. So as you can see, we have two extremes on the one hand and on the other. And actually, one realizes that if one actually wants to perform a unification, as Grothendieck had in mind, what is needed is an integration between the two levels, between the level of sites, or more generally presentations, and the abstract or metamathematical level of toposes where invariants are defined. And it is precisely by means of this duality that it is possible to generate deep applications in different mathematical areas. And in fact, here comes the metaphor of the bridge, because a bridge is a structure with two levels, the concrete level of sites or presentations and the level of toposes, which is where invariants are naturally defined, and it is essential not to collapse the two levels into one, neither to separate them from each other. So actually, this has been my main preoccupation, to develop techniques which allow one to integrate these two levels and therefore to realize this form of unification. So the first programmatic paper in which these ideas were presented is from 2010, and in the following years many applications of this have been obtained in different areas. What are the main principles underlying this use of toposes as bridges? Well, essentially, the main tool is to exploit the existence of different presentations for the same topos to transfer invariants across them. So, in fact, we have, for a given invariant, in general, many different manifestations of it in the context of different sites. So this is a typical example of a bridge. So you see you have two different sites giving rise to an equivalent toposes, and then one consider invariants of these toposes from the two different points of view. And in this way, one obtains properties that concretely can be completely different, but which in fact are related to each other by the fact that they come from the same invariant. So the bridge technique works like this. Well, here is just a list of applications of these techniques that have been obtained so far. So I'm not going to say anything precise about this. I just wanted to give an idea of the generality of the methodology, because it can be applied essentially everywhere. A couple of examples of bridges. Galois theory, for instance, can be understood as a bridge, and more generally, one can develop many new Galois-type theories in mathematics, even generalizing the Grothendieck's theory of Galois categories by using this perspective. So this is a theorem which you can find in my paper, Topological Galois Theory, which allows one to fabricate new Galois-type theories in different mathematical contexts, for instance, to generate Galois theory for finite groups, for finite graphs, for Boolean algebras, etc. And this goes beyond, in fact, Grothendieck's theory of Galois categories, which was already a significant generalization of classical Galois theory. And as you can see here, the role of toposes as bridges is crucial, because you can see the same topos represented in different ways, on the one hand by using an atomic site, on the other hand by using a group theoretic representation. And in fact, the content of Galois theory is really an equivalence between these different representations for the same topos, from which then one can try to extract more concrete relationships between the involved categories. Another example is stone-type dualities, which are a wide class of dualities between three-order structures and OSETs, locals, orthopological spaces, again, one can understood in a unified way all of these dualities in terms of topospheretic bridges of a particular form. These are bridges attached to the different structures. So for instance, the classical stone duality can be obtained from an equivalence between the topos of sheaves on a Boolean algebra with respect to the coherent topology and the topos of sheaves on the associated stone space. And similarly for the other dualities. So in this way, one gets a very general machinery for generating these dualities. Again, if you want to read about this, there is a paper with entitled A Topospheretic Approach to Stone Type Dualities. But these are just a couple of examples of bridges. Of course, there are many more. And in fact, what I would like to stress as a final remarks is that nowadays there are really no doubts anymore about the possibility for toposes to effectively act as unifying spaces across different contexts. In fact, toposes have really a creative power in mathematics, in the sense that studying them naturally leads to the discovery of a great number of important notions and results in different mathematical fields, and they allow to uncover hidden connections that would hardly be visible otherwise. So our plan is to continue the research along these lines. So here are a few main things that I will investigate together with my students and collaborators. And that's all. I think I have finished my time. So I just leave you with some references if you want to learn more about all of this. So there is this paper that is going to appear quite soon in the proceedings volume of the Lecture Grothendieckien given at the École Normale Supérieure in Paris 2 years ago. So this is a paper written in French, which discusses at much more length all these historical aspects, also these controversial aspects concerning the reception of toposes by commenting at length these Grothendieck's citations. And then if you want to learn more about this perspective of toposes as bridges, there is my habilitation thesis, which is a 100 pages text, which makes a survey of various bridges which have been discovered in the past years in different mathematical areas, and which is quite accessible even for non-specialists. And then there is my book, which is instead more technical, but which contains further results also of theoretical nature in this respect. So I stop here, and I thank you very much for your attention.